Yes, so the more advanced memory management idea is based on this paging concept, where I have page frames in the physical memory, and I have pages in my logical memory, and I put those pages into those page frames, or in short, frames. Okay, so it is conventional to go with powers of two, and yeah, so the frames can be of varying sizes depending on your system. They can hold only 512 bytes or like 16 megabytes or even more. So there is no final rule here. Yeah, so I divide my logical memory into blocks of the same size. So it doesn't have to be the same size of the frame size, but let's go with the same size for simplicity here. So we will do conversions with that in mind. So each page and the frame has the same size. So in other words, you can put only one page into one frame. Okay. So your operating system's memory management unit needs to keep track of all the free frames and give it to the process. To run a program of size n pages, now notice that my unit is not number of bytes anymore. I just deal with pages, okay? So a program is set to have size n pages. So to run it, I need to find n frames to accommodate it from properly, and then I then load the program. So it becomes an active process then once you find this availability. So I need some data structure called page table we to use to convert the logical addresses in your code into physical addresses where stuff actually leaves like the instructions. So I will go get it from a particular address, like some data. You have an array which is in your main memory. You need to go there, but actually you need to go to the physical address. But within your program, you have logical indices to that array, which are consecutive indices. But in reality, you have to convert that indices into physical addresses. And since now all the pages can be scattered throughout the main memory user space, not the kernel space. So in the user space, they can be anywhere. So I need to keep track of it with some page table structure, like a hash table. So I will not be able to just perform this very simple arithmetic conversion that I have done in the previous lecture, which was what? I have the base, the relocation register, plus the logical address, and then I get the desired physical address. But now the game is played differently. Yeah, so in this visual, we see that we have four frames, and here are the pages of the current process. Yeah, so I and here we also see a different example actually. So the size of the process here, the memory requirement of the process, is larger than the size of the physical space consisting of frames, right? But I can still run this thanks to this virtual memory concept based on paging idea. Basically, I will be able to run only part of it, but in reality, I am just running a particular subset of a process at a given time, right? I don't really actually execute all the instructions at the same time. So in this example, four pages, the pink ones, are stored in your four frames. For instance, this third frame, third page, is stored in the third page, okay, and so on. So we will later see page replacement ideas. So which page to kill and to move it out and put a new page onto that frame. So the decision of the frame to empty is an important decision, because I may recall, I may put the same page again in near future. Maybe I am inside a for loop, that's where I am repeating stuff. So then I don't want to replace that frame. Okay, so I have to be smart about it. But these are all future topics. Now let's stick with the current situation, where I have pages of my logical address space and they sit in frames of the physical address space. And here comes an example, I guess. I have a program which comes with this logical address space, and I have this physical memory which should accommodate that program. Again, the size of this physical memory can be smaller than this part. Currently, with paging, I can allow it. I can still make it run. But with the previous non-paging ideas, I wouldn't be able to do that. So now let's do the paging. I divide the physical memory into fixed size blocks, which are called frames or page frames, but in short, we call it frames. So in this example, I divide it into 10 blocks, 10 frames. So each frame will contain a content, and that content is a page. So where is a page? But before the page, let's talk more about the frames. So in assume that I have 4 kilobyte blocks. What does it mean? It means that I have 4096 bytes. Okay, within a frame. So for the first frame, which is here, indices go from 0 to 4,096.95. So in total, we have, starting from 0 index, 4,096 bytes. So every byte, you can think of it like this, every byte is for an instruction. Okay. Then the next frame begins from where we left off, etc. You get the logic, I guess. Okay, so this was the physical stuff. Let's go logical. I also divide the logical address space into fixed size blocks, assuming that I have the same size as the frame size, meaning that I will divide it into 4K, 4 kilobyte blocks. So with that logic, this block will contain 4,096 bytes, etc. When a program is loaded into memory, okay, as you can see, I have 6 pages, so I need to allocate 6 frames, or but I don't really have to put all the process to the RAM. So in this example, I am just putting 4 of the pages here. When a program is loaded into memory, allocation doesn't have to be contiguous, as you see here. They are not consecutive. I have some empty, black means empty, and gray means occupied. And actually, so it was my bad. Actually, so currently, I didn't make that allocation. So the black parts are empty parts that I can use for the loading. And I cannot use the gray parts, okay? So because it is holding the pages of a different process. So at the runtime, how do I load this program into memory, hence make it a process? So for instance, page 0 goes to frame 1. Page 3 goes to frame 7. So let's see it here, 3 to 7. So this is the page table I am talking about. It is like a hash table. So you can just keep pairs of integers here, left side from the logic and right side from the physical correspondence. So 3, 7, 4, 9, so 4 goes to 9, etc. And this information is kept in page table, and it is defined for each process separately. So here is one overhead for you. with every process, you have to maintain this array of numbers, okay? So it is inevitable. And actually, it has nothing to do with your instructions here, right? So this is a totally different set of memory allocation. But unfortunately, you need it to make that conversion from logical to physical address space within the CPU. You will do that. But just keep that in mind that the page table is an extra burden, is an extra entity that comes with every process. Extra but necessary. So in this example, what happens is I have page one, for instance. It happens to go to the frame four, starting with zero index. So yeah, frame four is this. And so on. So page three happens to go seven. Yes, it's correct. And again, this is physical memory versus logical memory. Keep that in mind. So let's do the conversion then. Let's work about it. Work on it. Assume I have 4 bytes of pages. Okay. So byte zero, byte one, byte two, byte three. So these 4 bytes, it is one page. Second page, third page, and fourth page. So in this example, I think I go with letter H. Okay, so this is maybe an instruction. Okay, an instruction sitting at index 7 in the logical space. So I want to go get that instruction from the main memory where it actually lives. Okay, so how to convert number 7 into number 27 actually, right? So because it is in index 24 5 6 7 27, what you do is the following. I have the logical address space 7, and I know that, so this is something I need to know. Page size is 4, I know that this page, I look at my page table for index 1, because I am on page 1, this page where H is involved. So physically, I need to go to index 6, so 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I need to come here, but coming here will just bring me to the beginning of this block. I need to also go to 3 offsets. So 24, 25, 26, and 27. So in general, the rule is page size times the page table output plus the offset. And actually, this is something we do with every instruction. Okay, so this is an extremely common operation in the CPU. I don't really want to execute extra multiplications, additions, so this should be extremely fast, like instant. And to that end, we use bits, actually, bit operations. So if you look at this template with 4-bit logical address, the first 2 bits of it from the left, the first 2 bits, you can say the most significant 2 bits, they represent the page number, okay? So which page it is. And then the next 2 is the offset that will allow you to travel within that page. Okay, so for the H example we have seen, the binary correspondence of number 7 is 0111, right? Remember, 1 times 2 plus, 1 plus 2 plus 4, 7. So, but it is decomposed into the following. So it implies, it gives you the page number, which is 1, right? It is 1, 01 is 1 in decimal. And also the index, so 11 in binary, which is 3 in decimal, right? 1 plus 2 is 3. So you will go to the index 3 here. Again, this is start from 0, 0, 1, 2, 3. So actually, this binary representation of 7 actually gives you a lot of information. The page number information, to use the page table properly, I need that one, that info. And then I also need the offset information, which is in the last two bits. And again, I need it in a later stage to travel within the physical frame. Another example, F. So what should I, where should I go to get the real F, not the logical F? So what is the binary of 5? It is 0101, right? Again, 1 and 4 is added. Remember, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32. So you multiply them with the digit below it. So 1 times 1, 2 times 0, 4 times 1. So I have 4 and 1, which is 5. Now, as we discussed, the first two tells me to go to page 1. So not to go there, but tells me that F is in page 1. Okay, very nice. So meaning that I need to go to the page table index 1. So this one is this one. And from here, I learn 6. So Jim, that will be the 6th or 7th, because I'm starting with 0. The 7th frame, I should go there. And when I go there, I will take one step only, because 0, 1 in binary is actually one in decimal. So which is true, right? Once I am here, I need to take one step to get F. So in other words, I convert 5 into 25, okay, which is the PA for F.
Hocam, we cannot see your cursor.
Okay. Yeah, but did you miss something without the cursor? Actually, I didn't do something very interesting with the cursor, but do you want me to repeat that conversion here?
Not really, but just the following, I said that.
Yeah, okay. We have another example anyway, so let's do it with cursor. So L, this byte. I need to go to the byte 11. So what is 11 in binary? So there are lots of zeros, ones here, but this 11 is decimal actually, so it's a bad coincidence, but anyway. So this is 11, right? 1 plus 2 plus 8. So I get 1 of 8, I get 0 of 4. So this is 11. Again, by our logic, the first two bits tells me the page where L lives in, which is page 2, right? Because 10 is 2 in decimal. So page 2 is this, and yeah, it is correct. Then the last two bits, 11, which is 3 in decimal, it tells me the number of steps to take within that page and also within that frame. Wait a second. Okay, so now if we come back to our business, so I am looking for the conversion of logical 11 into physical something. What is it? I don't know. So again, 11 in binary is 1011. The first two, which is 2 in decimal, so it means that I will be in page 2, but the page 2 will actually be the frame 1. Okay, so I go look at my page table, and this second index 2, I look at this entry, so I will go to index 1 in the frame world. So I will go to this frame, and now within this frame I need to take some steps. So that information is in the last two bits, which is 11 in binary, and in decimal it is 2, right? 1 plus 2 is, no, it is 3, sorry. 1 plus 2 is 3. So I will take three steps here. One, two, three. So it will bring me to index seven indeed. Four, five, six, seven. So the PA answer will be seven here. Yeah, with that logic, let's do it very quickly. And so I need to convert 13 into the physical address. So again, convert it to binary first, which is 1101. So take 8, 4, and 1. And then we have 13. First 2 1 1, but it is 3 in decimal. So I will look at index 3, which will bring me to the frame 2, 0, 1, 2. So I will be in this frame. And within this frame, I will take only one step because 0, 1 is 1 in decimal. So after 1, I will add 1 to 8. Is the answer. So in general, addresses generated by CPU is divided into the page number, which is the leading part, and the page offset, which is the following part. Page number P is used as an index into the page table, which contains base address of each page in physical memory. So it contains the starting address. Be careful, not somewhere random within the frame, just the beginning of the frame. Then the offset will be combined with that base address I just compute using the page table. And by combine, I will basically add it to that base. So combined with the base address to define the physical memory address that is sent to the memory unit. So then I will go to that particular physical memory address to get some data or some instruction from that memory. So what are our options then? If I have M for a given logical address space, for a given logical address space, I have 2 to the, what is this sentence, very missing stuff here, I think. But anyway, so with n bits here, you are able to generate 2 to the n different values, right? So you will have 2 to the n different offsets. So it means that actually offset, variety of offset determines the size of the page, right? Because I will add this number to my base starting point. So with 2 to the n, for instance, if n is 5, then it means that you can add at most 32. So this implies that your page size is 32, right? You cannot go to the 34th index because your offset doesn't allow you to do so. So this part determines the size of the page. And similarly, the logical address space as a whole has m bytes, m bits, m minus n is reserved for the page number, and n is for the page offset. Due to n, I understand that page size is n, but the logical address space, actually with m bits, you can create 2 to the n different address values. Okay, so just that. Here, let's talk about it. Okay, PD. So this is the logical address. Everything begins here because CPU sees this logical address that comes with the instruction and then uses the P as the index to the page table. So in other words, skip P entries and go to the index P starting from zero and learn this F, whatever it is, the frame number, and then put this frame number here. And after the frame number comes the offset. So notice that this offset is same as this offset because we established that page size and frame size are equal. So if you take 7 steps here within the page, you need to take 7 steps within the frame. So I just directly copy it. But I need a conversion from P to F which is done using page table. Then I have this thing, and I can now go get that entry. So this must be extremely fast because it is done for every memory reference. And at least one memory access to get the instruction, because memory reference is needed to get that instruction. And if that instruction contains a memory access, like it's an instruction that plays on an array, maybe you are doing sorting, merge sort at some point, you are currently updating your array, so some memory reference, it means a second memory access for the same instruction. But maybe it is just a comparison, like if condition, then that instruction doesn't cause any further memory access. So you don't need further conversion. However, you need at least one access to get that instruction, even if it is a if condition statement, you still need one memory reference to get that. So that's why I put this like separately, at least one memory access to fetch the instruction plus potential memory operations for that instruction, like load or save, etc. Setting up the page table is done by operating system kernel code, a software. So this is done for each process, and it is maintained by the operating system because pages come and go, but the frames are fixed. So you need to maintain that information. And again, it is the task of your operating system. When a program is loaded into memory, operating system knows into which frames the pages of the program are loaded. Yes, we were talking about it constantly. Okay, let's continue now. What is happening here? We will have free and used frames in memory at any time. Like this is the snapshot of your current system. Okay. So the new process, apparently it has four pages, okay? This is a process of size four. And we have these availabilities, so 13, 14, 15, 18, 20, and 15. Yeah, so the black ones are available, the blue ones are already occupied. So it means that I will be able to select four of these five, and it happens that page zero is mapped to the 14, frame 14, okay? And I need to keep that in my page table, so 0 to 14. Similarly, 1 to 13 here, 2 to 18, which is here, and page 3 goes to frame 20, 3 to 20. So we have this array called page table. Yes, actually, so this is just wrapping up what we are talking about, visual investigation of the page table and process. And now be careful, the free list is shrunk, okay? We lost all those four frames, and I just have 15 available now. So let's go with a more concrete example. 8-byte long program. Where is it? It is here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, so this is my program. Each byte is an instruction. Okay, so although I put a character here like A, you consider this as an instruction, okay? So what is happening here? Let's analyze this picture a little bit. So what's happening is, so I want to learn where F sits, for instance. So let's read from the beginning. M3 means that I have 8 logical address spaces. Okay, so M is this size of this string. Okay, 0, 0, 0, etc. I have 8 with 3 bits, I can create 8 logical addresses. And yeah, so I have an address for each instruction. So again, I have 8 instructions anyway. And I decided N is 2. So this is given to you. Your hardware configuration is like this. So it says that your page size is 4. So each page is able to accommodate 4 bytes, okay, 4 instructions. Okay, so it means that you will reserve these two, the last two, as the offset, right? Because it can be as big as 4. With 2 bits, you can create numbers that are from 0 to 3. 1, 1 is 3. So you can go, you can jump 0 steps, 1 step, 2 steps, or 3 steps. So in other words, you have 4 locations with 0 jump, meaning that you are in the beginning of that page. So then, for instance, your CPU is fed with this instruction, okay, whose logical address is 101. So again, 01 is the offset, so 1. I will go 1 unit once I find the correct frame. So where is the correct frame? It is written in the first bit. So in this scenario, I don't have 2 bits for the page table because I don't need. I just have 2 pages, so 2 bits. 1 bit is okay. So bit 1 means that go look at the index 1 in the page table, which moves me to index 2, because this is binary. So 0, 1, 2. I will go here. But actually what happens is the value here, again, to the beginning. So this goes to the beginning, which is 1, 0. And then 0, 1 is just copy-pasted here. So you need to go to this entry, but in binary it is 1001. What is this in decimal? It will be 1 plus 8, which is 9. Okay. And it makes sense because 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So you are really hitting the physical address of 9 here. And the bits are already telling you this without making any multiplications. So how do I implement a page table? So it is nothing more than an array, but let's see the details. Page table is kept in main memory per process. Okay. Yeah, we established that. Page table base register, PTBR, it points to the page table. Yes, and every page table has a length, has a size, which is stored in this register, PTLR, length register. It indicates the size of the table. So now I get this table with the starting point and with the size so that I don't overshoot. In this scheme, every data or instruction access requires 2 memory accesses. One for the page table, because it is in memory, I bring it, and then one for the data or the instruction. Yeah, so let me repeat this. So to execute an instruction, which is what I want, actually it is the heart of the story, I can't just execute instruction. I need to get the page table to learn the physical address of that instruction, because I need the page table to do that. So I make one memory access to use the page table, and then I also need another access to get the instruction, because it is also in the memory. So two is necessary. So here I am showing those two accesses. The first access to the page table in memory, logical to physical conversion. Where is it? and then the second access is to the physical address in memory, which is the second address. So if we look at this picture, what is happening here, let's understand it carefully. I have for instance two processes in memory currently, and process one is executing in the single CPU with the current instruction whose number is in this program counter. So using this program counter, I go to the memory. So every line here, this curves, they are access, okay? So it is going and getting that instruction. But first, this is happening. First, I use the PTBR of this process to go to the correct page label. Be careful, I also have another page label which is irrelevant because it belongs to P2. I need to go to the correct page label in the kernel space, because page tables, they are not maintained by user. They are invisible to user. Operating system is responsible to maintain it and store it and update it. So I don't really care about it. But in reality, my time matters. I need to do this memory access without knowing it. In the background, this happens. Using the PTBR of the current process, I go to the table, process table of me, my process table. And from here, I learn the page number, the frame number that holds the current page of this instruction. Now, I go to that frame in the user space of the main memory, and I also do the offset, which is encoded in the logical address, and I get the instruction. So 1, 2, I have two access. Again, access to page table, the bottom curve, and then access to the physical address for the instruction fetch, which is the second curve. Here, two memory access problem can be solved actually. So don't make that many accesses. So I can do the following trick. I can use a special fast lookup hardware cache called associative memory, or TLB. So more common name is translation look aside buffer. Okay. So for a fast lookup, I will keep that in the cache, okay, which is a memory closer to the CPU, so faster access. So I will avoid the main memory access for the process table, okay? So let's see the details about it. Some TLBs, translation look aside buffers, they store address space identifiers in each entry, okay? So this identifier uniquely identifies each process to provide address space protection for that process. Okay, so it means that there is only one TLB, but lots of processes are using it. So I need identifiers per process to not to mess with the other processes' entries. After we learn the page to frame conversion, which is what page table does, remember, but now I will learn it using the cache, not the main memory. We store this association in one entry of translation look aside buffer. So here is an example. A page has 4096 instructions, so it is likely that it will access the same page again, right? So because with one page, you basically have 4000 instructions with you. If every entry is an instruction, let's assume that way. So, and probably unless you are making a function call to go to somewhere weird, you are executing the consecutive instructions. Okay, so in other words, once you load the page, it is likely that you will access the same page again and again soon. So you can keep that page to frame mapping in your cache then. So this is the idea. So let's go visual about it. Here is our TLB memory. So I have page to frame conversion, right? This page is in this frame. This page is in this frame. Address translation is, if P is in the associative register, so is if it is already here, that mapping is already in this cache, then just use that corresponding value of frame. Read it from here. Otherwise, get frame number, not from here because it doesn't exist here. Just get it from the main memory as usual, as before. So now with that hardware setup with the TLBs, this is your new logic, okay? So this is your current and most up-to-date memory management unit, the conversion part of the memory management unit. Again, you are executing an instruction in CPU, and instruction has this logical address. So CPU have access to that logical address. Now all my task is to convert it into a physical address. So what is this box doing then? So with the logical address, as we have seen before, it consists of two parts. The page number part, the beginning, and the offset part, the rest. The offset is not so interesting. It will be maintained here exactly. So D comes here as D. But for the P, page number, I first look at my TLB, the translation look aside buffer, okay? And I look for that P in these indices. So in this example, I have 2, 4, 6, 7 alternatives. So if that page number is here, then I know it's frame number because it's a hit. I have already saved it in this little memory. So this is a very small memory compared to this, compared to the main memory. This big physical memory where the page table sits somewhere here. Okay, so if it is here, I know that F value. So this is a hit. Then I just write that F value here. So in other words, if page number 2 is going to frame 7, then this 2 is converted into 7 in binary, of course. So you will go to the 7th frame here. And if I go to the 13th address, 13th location in that page, then I will go to the 13th location in the 7th frame. Okay, so I will go somewhere like index 20, then 7 plus 13 is 20. But of course, they all happen in the physical addresses. Yeah, so this is the beauty of TLB. It's a very important mechanism. And if TLB hit doesn't occur, then actually I feed this P into my page table, which is located in this physical memory, in the kernel space of the physical memory. So I will get it by this memory access, which is slower than the cache access here. But definitely I will find my P to F conversion here, because this page table, after all, this is its task. So I will learn the F eventually and put it here. And again, what I say here is I want to emphasize it again. So a page has many instructions in it, okay, like 4,000 instructions. So it means that once I have, for instance, instruction 2025, if it is my first instruction to execute in the CPU, okay, 2025. So due to 2025, I bring this page to frame conversion into my TLB, okay, because 2025, that page didn't occur here initially. So I learned that the page number which holds 2025, so let's say that it is the page 12. So I learned that 12 goes to frame 21. So I know the 12 to 21 conversion. So I put it here, okay? I put 12 here and 21 here. And the good news is, remember, I was doing 2025, so I am likely to do 2026 next, okay? Because this is the next instruction. Unless I am doing a function jump or something, I will just do the next instruction. And 2026 is in the same page as 2025, which was page 12. But luckily, I already established 12 to, what did I say? 20, I guess, whatever, not important. 12 to 20 conversion. So I will learn it from here. I will not go to the page table in the kernel memory, physical memory, to learn 12 to 20 conversion. Okay, so this is, the hits are likely to occur. So this is a very effective mechanism, that's why. And actually, let's investigate it even further. So what can be my hit rate and miss rate? So let's talk about this. We have effective, so what is the effective memory access time with TLB, okay? So now that I have, so associative lookup, the TLB lookup is extremely fast, okay? It is like epsilon. E is epsilon, and the memory access is, it takes one cycle. Let's say that it takes 1 millisecond. And again, E is much smaller than milliseconds. Okay, so TLB time is E, memory access time is one. Let's take it 1 millisecond, and E is less than one. So hit ratio, assume that I hit the percentage of times that a page number is found in the TLB. So that 12 to 20 conversion, it's a hit. So alpha is a number between 0 and 1, right? It's a percentage of times. Either 100%, like 1, or 0%, like 0, or 50%, 0.5, etc. Then the access is like this. I will look at my... so what is this talking about? If there is a hit, it means that I make one access to the TLB and I find the page to frame conversion, and then I make one access to main memory. So this one is main memory to get the instruction because it is in the main memory. I don't put the instruction here. It doesn't fit. I just put two numbers here, 12 for page number and 20 for the frame number. So I just store a very little information in this little cache. So again, if there is a hit, E is the TLB lookup time plus one is the instruction fetch time. And this happens alpha many times. So maybe it always happens, then alpha is one and I don't have any means. So this is one plus E is all I have as my access time. But in general, with alpha probability of hit, 1 minus alpha probability of miss, right? Because these are identically independent events from your probability years. If alpha probability is hit, then miss probability is 1 minus alpha. And in that case, unfortunately, I made this access to lookup. It didn't, I said unfortunately, because it didn't help me. I didn't find my frame number, so it didn't help me. So what I do is I do one access for the page to frame conversion and then another access for the instruction fetch, two. So I have a cost of 2 plus E. And now let's open this. What happens is, I don't know, so alpha plus E alpha, and there is minus E alpha, so that cancels away. And if you do all the full extension, let's not do it here, then it happens to give you 2 plus E minus alpha milliseconds of access time. So again, E is very small, negligible, so it is like, without TLB, you definitely have 2 seconds, 2 memory access, but now you have 2 minus alpha, okay? So you decrease that with the probability of making hits. So again, if you have a very nice cache maintenance and you get lucky, then alpha can be as big as 1. So 2 minus 1, then you will have 1 as your effective access time, which is the best you can do, right? Because after all, you need to make 1 access to get the instruction, which is the whole story. Okay, let's stop here because this is a good point where we also discuss the TLB business. And next lecture, we will continue with the other aspects of this memory management. Yes, so continuing with the memory management, I now come into this validation and invalidation part of the page table. Basically, page table is an array, one-dimensional array. Let's make it two-dimensional, okay, 1 and 2, to put a bit, 0 or 1, or valid or invalid, to talk about the validation of that part. So, 1 second. Yes, another interrupt in our operating systems class. A valid indicates that the associated page table in that row is in the process's logical address space. Okay, so it's a valid mapping, in other words. And invalid means, so there is still an entry, a non-zero entry, in that location, but currently it is invalid. Okay, so you shouldn't use it. It is not a rocket science, actually. It is just an additional information. Sometimes additional things require, not sometimes, always, additional things require additional processing. So you need also to maintain this V and I parts now. But this is useful because after all, although in this example, it seems that we already have weird entries, but sometimes you will, it looks like sensible entry to you. So for that process, you may have to go to that page, page 6, for instance, and you learn that there is already an association with it, like frame 5. You go to frame 5. But in reality, we don't have frame 5. That's why you shouldn't take that step. So you will look at this second bit. If it is invalid I, then you don't consider that movement. What you do instead is you request that page and put it to the frame, physical frame. Okay, so a page replacement or a new page bringing should happen. Okay, next issue is about sharing stuff. So shared pages, you will see lots of overlap. So for instance, you have a multiple instance of the Microsoft Word open in your system at a given time, and although the text in each of these Word documents are different, so in one of them you are writing your operating system midterm exam question, in another one you are writing a recommendation letter for a student, like based on my experience of the previous week. So what I try to come is, where I try to come is, some pages of the Microsoft Word will be the same in both those applications, although the text part is different, so maybe you need different pages for that part, but the graphical user interface, that icons and other background processing are most likely, actually not most likely, definitely the same in those processes, so I can share the pages. Okay, this is the idea we will study now. You can also share code, one copy of the code of code shared among processes like the Word example. Because again, once you have two Microsoft Word open, actually the same code is in the memory because the same process. Again, the different part is not about the instructions of that software, okay? Same instructions, but the text field, the editing field is different. And similar, this is similar to the multiple thread sharing the same process space. Remember, we have the same address space and multiple threads are using it. Also useful for inter-process communication if sharing of read and write pages is allowed, as we will see. But unlike the shared parts, we also have private stuff like private code and data. Each process keeps a separate copy of the code and data. So this is private. They deserve different pages. The pages for the private code and data can appear anywhere in the logical address space. Yeah, so let's go with an example here. I have P1, P2, P3, okay, different colored processes. Yeah, so P1 is using this data one, and it has some, so these are like the code parts of the process, okay? But the different data is loaded into its own array, okay? Although they use the same array, same instruction for that, but the content of the array here is different and here is different. So like the content of the array is the words in your text fields in your Microsoft Word, for instance. I am just making up here. So what we have here is actually the page table of P1 will have four locations for you to go because you have four pages. So add one goes to frame three. Let's verify it here. Add two. So I think this add is for editor, right? Probably. Editor code. Editor 2 goes to frame 4. So it is not a simple code. There are many codes, so it didn't fit into one page. And editor 3, that page goes to frame 6. Yes, it is here, editor 3. And now here is the sharing happening. Editor 3 has already gone to frame 6, okay? So then process 3 will just put 6 here. And similarly, process 2 for the editor 3 entry, which is 012012 here, I put 6 here. Basically, I shared the first three pages, okay? That's why I have the same values in the first three locations of the page tables, but the data parts are different. In particular, data of process 1 goes to frame 1, which is here. Of process 3 goes to frame 2, which is here. And data of process 2 goes to frame 7, which is here. Yes, so this is also logical, I hope, that to you. It makes sense. It is for saving frames. Now let's talk about the structure of the page table. So far, I have used a single one-dimensional array, but let's think about the problems that may come with it. So 1D page table can grow to a large size if you have a large address space. Remember, I may have a program with 4 gigabytes of logical memory, and this is a very common thing because I am in a 32-bit system, okay? And it means that with 32 bits, I can create this many locations, okay? With each permutation of ones and zeros, I have 4 gigabytes of different permutations. Let's continue. A page is a smaller amount Obviously, that is the point. I will put a part of the program into each page. Let's assume that this is 4 kilobytes, which is a reasonable assumption. Then what is the number of pages you need to accommodate this 4 gigabytes size program? You need 1 million entries, because 4 gigabyte over 4 kilobyte is 1 million. Again, kilobyte, 1,000 more, you hit megabytes, and another 1,000 megabytes will give you gigabytes, right? So I have 1,000, three zeros, and another three zeros. So I have 6 zeros in the end. It is 1 million. So it is very terrible. If you notice, I need 1 million pages. In other words, I need 1 million entries, because each page, like page 7, it needs a value like 16, 7 goes to frame 16. And I will have 1 million of such pairs, okay, apparently, which is terrible, because if each entry is 4 bytes, like I am storing a 32-bit integer address, okay, which is the frame, it's essentially an integer address or hexadecimal, whatever, so it is 4 bytes. And I have 1 million of them. So what is 4 times 1 million? It is 4 megabytes, right? So 1,000, 4 kilobytes, and another 1,000 for the megabytes. So I spent all those 6 zeros to go from 4 byte to 4 megabytes. So in other words, what just happened is I am spending 4 megabytes of main memory just to keep this bookkeeping information, okay? Which is a very important information, don't misunderstand me, but this is too much, because my software is already 4 gigabytes. So relative to 4 gigabytes, it may seem even okay to you, but this is annoying, okay? So why do I give you 4 megabytes just to make some bookkeeping? So, and there are solutions to this problem. You can do hierarchical paging, hashed page tables, and inverted page tables. And all of them have this logic. Break up the logical address space into multiple page tables. So don't use only one page table of 1D. Use multiple page tables that are cascaded. Let's study hierarchical page tables then. I will break up the logical address space into multiple page tables, okay? So some portion of the logical address space will be mapped by some page table. Okay, so I have this huge logical space, and not only one table is going to deal with it, okay? I will segment it, and one segment will be served by one table, and another segment or portion will be served by another page table, and so on. Hence, you don't have a single page table responsible for the whole address space mapping. You have multiples of them. Usually, you usually use a small portion of your logical address space anyways, right? So given at a given time, although you have 4 gigabytes of logical memory for your Counter-Strike video game, you don't really execute all of them at once. You are at a given region of your game, so you are just involved with some little subset of instructions. So that's why this makes sense. You need small page tables to map those partitions. Unused partition or portion, unused portion is stored on disk. I don't even bring it to the memory. I will bring it to the memory when there is a reference over there. Okay, so let's see a two-level page table. Even two-level will solve lots of problems, and you can do more levels, but let's do two-level. So what's happening here? I had this author page table which is level 1, and then comes the inner level, level 2 page table. So in other words, this is a page table and it points to other page tables. Okay, see? And then this page tables, they actually have the requested, required frame numbers, because I will go there. So that information is here, but how to go to this red box? I need to hit to the correct arrow here. So this is what we will study. The idea is you page the page table, okay? You page like call, paging. If you are a doctor or you know a doctor, they know this paging term. You page, you call the page table, and here you page the frame. Okay, so this is the logic. So first continuous 1,000 pages, for instance, in this example, are served, are mapped by the circled page table. Okay, then the next 1,000 pages are mapped by the next page table, etc. Okay, so the first 1,000 pages are mapped by this. But why do I say 1,000 in the notes here? I have 500 stuff here. Am I missing something? No. Yeah, okay. So not important. The important thing is these pages running from 1 to 500. Yeah, so maybe, yeah, okay, now it is clear to me. So they don't have to be in increasing order. These are just page numbers, okay? This, the last is the page 500, but here I may have a page 799, for instance. So I have 1,000 pages here, okay? So 1,000 pages. So, and each page has the frame mapped by this red circle. Another 1,000 page is served by this page table. So I have 1,000 entries here. So the first page in this block uses frame 100, this frame. The last page in this block uses frame 708. Okay, so this is the frame. Okay, clear. Now then, it is clear. If only a small portion of the logical address space from the beginning is used, okay, which is the common case, only a small portion is used, it may be enough just to have circled page table in memory. Okay, so although all these information is valuable, currently, for instance, I am in the beginning of the program, which is dealing with the first 1,000 pages. So again, I quantify the size of my program process in terms of number of pages. So the first page, second page, etc. I can bring all 10,000, 1,000 pages into memory in the beginning. I select them from the first 1,000 because this is the logical thing to do. After all, you start from the main function. But the pages ranging from 1,001 to other future values, they are, although I have the mapping, I just store it them in the disk currently. I don't bring them to memory because I will have frequent access to this block. This is the idea. Now let's see how I can do this thing precisely. Logical address on a 32-bit machine with 1 kilobyte of page size. Let's assume this configuration, okay? I have a 32-bit machine, so I can have 2 to the 32, like 4 gigabyte of instructions, 4 gigabyte of logical memory for a given process, and I will distribute it into pages of 1 kilobytes. How to do that? Here you see I have 32 bits in total. 12 plus 10 plus 10 is 32. Again, if you recall the very first discussions of our memory management journey, I have the page number bits followed by the page offset bits. Again, page offset is trivial. It is just the number of steps you will take within the page and also within the frame in the physical memory. So it is D. I will reserve 10 for that, which will give me 2 to the power of 10 steps to take within a page. What does it imply? It says that you have 1K, because 2 to the 10 is 1024, which is 1 kilobyte. Okay. And since I am given 1K in the beginning, so they tell me that you have 1 kilobyte of page size, then you will reserve 10 bits to that. Okay. So this is your 10 bits. You cannot use it for the page number part. Okay. So D is equal to 10. This is established. Now I have 22 bits at my disposal. I will reserve 12 bits of it for the first level page table that pages to other page tables, and I will reserve the 10 bits to the for the second level of page table. Okay, what does it mean? That second level page table can have at most 2 to the 10, 1 kilobyte entries. Okay, 1K entries. But the first level can have much more entries. So if you look at here, here I will have 4,000 entries. But here I will have like 1,000 circles like this. And each circle is a different page table. So page P1 is an index to the outer page table. Okay. P2 is an index to the inner page table, which actually stores the page to frame conversions. Okay, so that is the second level, page to frame conversion. The real deal is here, but I just select the correct second level page table using this first level page table, which stores mapping is to select the correct page table. And B is trivial. It is the offset to travel within the page or in the frame. So let's see things more clearly with this visual. So when I give you P1, you will look at the index P1 in the outer page table. So it will tell you to use the seventh page table, maybe. Okay, so I have 1,000 page tables here. I will use the seventh one. So here is the seventh one then, and within the seventh page table, this guy, I will use the entry P2. So the desired page is apparently in index 13, maybe. Okay, so I will go look at the index 13, and it tells me to go to frame 66. Then this is the frame 66, and within the frame 66 you will go D many steps to get your content from the main memory, because here this is the main memory. So let's also read it here. From outer table here, get the address of the second level page table, which is this inner table. And from that second level inner table, get the frame number, which is in physical memory, because frames are in physical memory. Remember, pages are in logical memory. Frames are storing the pages in physical memory. Yeah, so okay, go get that frame number. And once you are in that frame here in the physical memory, get the desired content after looking at the index D, lead entry. So what just happened? Let's see things more clearly. What is the benefit? I reduce the page table space needed for a given program because I have now many page tables around and only one of them in main memory, not all of them. So if your logical address space is 32 bits, and so in this example, I think it is happening. Yes, so 32 bits, 2 to the 32. So this is the logical address space. Page size is 4 kilobytes, which is a reasonable assumption. 2 to the 12, like 4,096 entries. Logical address division is 10, 10, 12. Okay, because so now be careful, the offset is 12 because with 12 I can serve 4K. With 10, I can serve only 1K. Okay, so now I have 10 and 10 for my page tables. So a program has 4 gigabyte address space as we see here, but only uses bottom and top portions currently. Okay, it may happen. So these pages are in use. Maybe these are referring to instructions calling functions that are in different pages here. So currently, only these guys are in use. And if you look carefully, the portion here is like 20 megabyte. 8 from here, 20 from here. And the drawing here is confusing because everything here is like 4,000 megabytes. So the black space is much bigger than it looks here. But you, I hope that it is clear to you. Now, don't need a page table for this part, because I really don't use it currently. Need only one top level page table at all times, because this will always point me to the correct page table. But I need how many second level page tables to serve 20 megabytes of data? So what is 20 megabytes? Actually, I think I am solving it here. I need to access 20 megabytes only. So the second level page table has 2 to the 10 entries, okay? Because of this division given to you, 2 to the 10. So each entry, take one entry here, okay? Like this one here, the gray one. Each entry can map a page of 4K size because a page is 4 kilobytes. So what is happening? I have 2 to the 10 entries here, and each entry is able to map 2 to the 12. So what is the sum, multiplication? 2 to the 22, which is 4 megabytes of logical address space. So what just happened is, with a page table, I am able to handle 4 megabytes of logical data, logical space. With a single page table, because it has this many entries and each entry is able to map this many bytes. So 4 megabytes. But what I need to map 20 megabytes. So apparently we will need 5 page tables then, right? Yeah, so this is the logic here. Yeah, this 5 is coming here. Yeah, actually this is it. So what else, do I miss something in the figure? So let's also follow the same argument using this figure. So 10 bits here gives me 2010 possibilities, 2010 or 1021 different entries. Each entry will point me, will put a page to the main memory, right, to a frame. So a given page holds 4 kilobytes of data, and I have 1024 of them. So that's why you need to multiply. So whole table is able to transfer this amount of data. And If you recall, I need 20 megabytes of data. So with one page table, I can't map it. I need 5 different page tables. Which 5? It will be selected correctly, but I need to select 5 of them. Yeah, so this is the logic. Okay, it is even continuing. So benefit, using the whole address space, which is 4 megabyte per process, remember, of 1 DKs, now reduces to only 24 kilobyte per process. Okay, it is an incredible reduction, because I will now just store 4 page tables. Assume each entry in both top level and second level tables are 4 bytes, then I have 24 kilobyte of storage for this bookkeeping, not 4 megabyte. Here actually this picture is also talking about it, so let's also cover that picture. I have this address space again, 20 megabyte of them is going to be used, so I need to handle that white parts. I have in my top level table, I have 2 to the 10 entries, okay, 1000 rows here, 1024 to be exact. And I need this in memory at all times, because this will point me to the correct page tables. So what is the cost here? It is 2 to the 10. So it is 1 kilobyte. And with in the second level, page tables 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I remember I was going to use 5 and 5 tables. So what happens is, again, in the top level, I need 1 kilobyte of memory, but not just 1 kilobyte, be careful. Every entry is 4 bytes, because this is an integer address pointing to the beginning of this page table. So I need 4 bytes, 32 bits. So I need 4K times 4 bytes, okay, coming due to this part. And what about the others? For each page table, I have again 1K, 1024 to be exact, entries, because this is given by here, 1010, okay. So 1000 entries, and each entry is basically an integer pointing to the frame ID. So 1K times 4 bytes, but I have 5 of them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So then what is this then? I have 1 kilobyte times 4 bytes plus 5 kilobyte times 4 bytes. So does it make 24 kilobytes? So it is kind of weird. Maybe it does. I don't know. I am a little overwhelmed here. But so if you take it, I have 6 kilobytes of data, and each is 4 bytes. Yeah. Anyway, so this is according to my current state. It is even less than 24 kilobytes, because I have just 6 kilobytes, and they are so 1 kilobyte is multiplying 4 bytes. So these are not kilobytes, right? Sorry, my bad. So this K is like 1000, okay, 1K. Then I have 4 kilobyte here, plus 20 kilobyte, and hence we have 24 kilobyte. Yes, this is correct. Okay, but I hope that, so this is the moral of the story. With one dimensional page table, you would require 4 megabyte of additional data per process. Be careful, only for one process. Now you are using much smaller amount of physical memory for that bookkeeping. What is the bookkeeping? Page to frame conversion. And actually, we can go into more levels, like tree level is also useful because with, especially with 64-bit systems like the ones we have these days, okay, the page table, you will reserve like 2 to 12, like 4 kilobytes to the pages, but then you will remain, you will end up with this many bits, 52 bits to distribute between the page hierarchy. So if you distribute it like 42 to 10, then every process has to have an outer table. Remember, this outer table must be in the memory at all times. Okay, so this is fixed. But only a selection of inner tables will be in memory. But if you put 42 here, then it means that you will have 2 to the 42, which is like, again, in the order of gigabytes here. That thing is kept in memory. So we should leave small space here. Like if you leave 32, then you can have one and second levels. But then two to the 32 is actually 4 gigabytes. Then this is even worse. 2 to the 32 is still huge for the top level page table. So maybe you should even use more levels. Okay, but I am just showing the logic here. So this is a good point to stop because to solve this one-dimensional page table problem, I have introduced the hierarchical page table now. There are two more alternatives, like the hash-based and the inverted base. Actually, let me also handle the hash-based stuff, then we will just begin with this session freshly in the next week, virtual memory, where we do this page replacement stuff, etc. But let's talk about the hashed page tables. Again, my motivation is to replace the one-dimensional page table with other page tables that are not always in the memory. I just use the active ones in memory, and the others are in the disk. So hashed page table gives me a similar functionality. So actually, this is also a good solution to the to this 2 to the 32 or 2 to the 42 bits of fixed outer table storage problem of the hierarchical page table. So I said you can even create more levels, but then still you can make this so this outer table will have to point to all the others, right? So it will be big eventually. That's why hierarchical stuff is not very convenient for especially 64 bits hardwares, 64 bit hardwares. In the hashed page table arises after exceeding a threshold address space sync length. So basically, again, this is the whole story. I have this logical address P part that will point me to the correct entry in the page table, and the offset. The offset is not a big deal. I just use the same offset. So if you go 7 units in the page, then you should go 7 units in the corresponding frame. But what is the corresponding frame? So what is R here? So you feed this P, which will lead you to the correct page table. So with this P, you reduce this large number. Again, this can be a large number, like in the order of 2 to the 32. So maybe a value close to 4 trillion or something. So you map it into this 0 to 1000 interval. Okay, so there will definitely be collisions, but you will use your hash table knowledge from data structures, so you can use linear probing or separate chaining, that stuff, if you recall. So you can handle that. So this hash table will then return you this Q value, okay? It will lead you to the outer level page table, from where you will go to the inner level page table, the correct, the good one. And from here, you have this P2 frame mapping. And now I use this frame value. And with that, I go to the physical memory. Yes, so this is the end of the process table, page table management. And with that, we stop.